हेलो फ्रेंड्स, दिस इज कार्तिकेय सिंह, असिस्टेंट प्रोफेसर वर्किंग इन स्कूल ऑफ मैनेजमेंट साइंसेस वाराणसी। वी आर कवरिंग रिसर्च डिजाइन, एंड इन रिसर्च डिजाइन वी हैव ऑलरेडी कवर्ड थ्री पार्ट्स ऑफ इट एंड वी आर इन टू द फोर्थ पार्ट, एंड इन फोर्थ पार्ट ऑल्सो वी हैव कवर्ड मेजर पार्ट एंड वी आर इन टू दिस टाइप्स ऑफ एक्सपेरिमेंटल रिसर्च डिजाइन। इन टाइप्स ऑफ एक्सपेरिमेंटल रिसर्च डिजाइन we have covered pre-experimental research designs, quasi-experimental research design, and true experimental research design, and we are into the last part, that is statistical research design, and in this we are going to cover completely randomized design, randomized block design, Latin square design, and factorial design. We'll cover all these types one by one. So let's move to the next slide. Before that, erase it, otherwise it will go into the next slide. So let's start with the concept of statistical design. What does this say? A statistical design allows for a statistical control analysis of external variables. The main advantages of statistical designs are as follows. The effect of more than one label of independent variable on dependent variable can be manipulated. So it takes care of building a relationship between independent and dependent variable, but with one independent variable on different dependent variable can be measured here. The effect of more than one independent variable can also be examined, and the effect of a specific extraneous variable can be controlled. So major objective of doing this experimental research design is to negate the impact of extraneous variable. So there are several ways we have already studied in previous type, like in true experimental research designs, in Solomon four group or pre and post design or post designs. In all those designs, major objective was to control the extraneous variable. So this statistical design is also going to do the same work, but here procedural difference would be there, and this is the most structured research designs. So what these people are saying here, let's go through one by one. The main advantages of this statistical research design is more than one label of independent variable on the dependent variable can be manipulated. Suppose price is one independent variable and dependent variable is your sales. So price can be manipulated in three ways: high price, medium price, and low price. So we can check the variability of high, medium, and low price on the sales of that particular commodity or the product. So this statement says that different label of independent variable relationship on dependent variable can be manipulated through this statistical technique. Next, what these people are saying, the effect of more than one independent variable, can be examined. Likewise, I have already given you the example, like high, medium, and low, three independent variable and three subdivision of one independent variable has been observed, and we usually gauge the different repercussion of that price variability on sales performances. The last one is, the effect of a specific extraneous variable can be controlled by this statistical research design. So these are the three basic advantages of a statistical design. And in statistical design, we are going to cover one by one, completely randomized block, Latin square, and factorial design. Let's move further. First, erase this mark and move. Completely randomized block design. What does this say? In completely randomized block design, the researcher is investigating the effect of one independent variable on one dependent variable. Very important. Researcher is inclined to build a relationship between. Effect of one independent variable on dependent variable. So one independent variable would be there, and one independent variable, I'll take one example in the next slide and it will clarify this concept. One independent variable can be taken as price, and one dependent variable can be taken as sales. So if movement in price can be gauged on the performance of sales, and these two variables are directly related to each other. So we'll cover it in the next slide also. The independent variable is required to be measured at nominal scale, and this is an important concept. Like four kind of scales are there, measurement scales are there: nominal, ordinal, interval, and ratio. For the time being, if this nominal is there, because in measurement, a third unit, measurement and a scale description, this entire nominal, ordinal, interval, and ratio scales would be discussed much in detail. But what does this mean? Nominal, what we are usually infer to this nominal means, nominal scale is used to give certain identity to a particular commodity or process or events, like your raw number. Or raw number is not having any significance related to your performance. Raw number is just allocated to identify your individuality in a particular classroom. Like raw number one starts with A, B, C, D, E, F, G, H in alphabetical order. So one particular fellow has got that raw number. That means he is been nominated, and that nomenclature is given. So assigning a particular number to any individual is basically considered as nominal scale. You can take one more example, like in any horse racing contest, every horse is usually being assigned a particular number. So if you are assigning 1, 2, 3, 4 whatever digits to those horses, it is basically going to be considered as nominal scale. But once those horses will run and perform, and on the basis of their performance, few of them will fetch rank 1, 2, and 3. So if the order in which they have performed will be nominated as ordinal scale on the basis of their performance. Likewise, their performance may fall in certain intervals, like few horses will be able to perform between 10 to 11 seconds, few 11 to 12 seconds, few 12 to 13 seconds. So their performance may fall between certain intervals. That's why they are going to be called as interval scale. And finally, by what percentage the first one was ahead of the second, and by what percentage if mediocre performers were a laggard from the top performers, all those things can be calculated through ratio scale. So these are the four scales. Nominal scale just for giving some identity, and it has no meaning but to give identity, and you cannot add, subtract, or multiply with this number. It just gives you identity or identification in particular situation. Ordinal scale tells you about the performance, but what margin that performance would be, they are not going to tell. Ratio scales, interval scales tells you at in what category your performance is going to fall, and in ratio scale, but what margin or by what percentage what particular performance is being done. So these are the four scales. Here we are concerned about your nominal scale, and in all those scales we are going to cover much in detail in future. Now, what the third point is saying, each categories of the independent variable, each category of this independent variable is considered as a treatment. Independent variable, like if you are increasing and decreasing the sales price, that independent variable can be considered as treatment or exposure, because we are changing price. So that price change is going to be considered as treatment. Likewise, in previous examples of sales training was the treatment. Here, price manipulation or price change is going to be considered as the treatment. Then next, basic assumptions of this design is that there are no differences in the test units. On whichever test units we are implicating sales of performance, or we are going to measure the sales performance on the basis of the price change, all those test units are identical in nature, the same kind of identical. So what kind of test units is going to be there? Like one commodity or one product, we can consider this as a taste units. For example, if we are going to consider the price of milk or price of any FMCG product, the same kind of product will be considered throughout the experiment. And there is no differences would be there in the taste units in terms of size, in terms of quality, in terms of shape, in terms of packaging. So identical taste units is going to be considered for this experiment. Last one, there are no extraneous variable, though it is impossible. There are no extraneous variable that could influence the outcome. It is just an assumption, but it is not going to be a reality at any cost. Because in most of the cases, extraneous variable usually impacts your sales performance. So this is it up to this slide. Let's, before moving ahead to the next slides, let's raise all these marks. And we'll consider one example of this completely randomized. So we are taking example of sales of a particular goods is influenced by the price of that goods. So sales and price. Price is going to be considered as your independent variable, and sales is going to be considered as your dependent variable. So let's take we are into completely randomized plot design. So this is the example. Price and sales. Price is independent variable and sales is dependent variable. We can consider three types of prices, like high price. I have denoted it as H price, medium price, then low price. And on the basis of these three prices, we can gauge which particular price category is more influenced and giving us the highest sales. So if we'll be able to establish a relationship between these three types of prices, we'll be able to tell that which particular price is more influential in giving higher sales. So we have to measure one by one. And if you want to measure it, what you can do, we can take five shops which are selling their product at higher price. We are going to take five shops which are selling their products with a particular product, a specific product. Take for an example, like milk. If one particular shop, five particular shops are there which are selling at high price, five shops are there which are selling at the medium price, and five of them are selling at the low price. So we have to take the best possible combination, which is giving the exact values, highest sales performance. So how price is influencing your sales out of these three combinations, and these three combinations can be guessed through variance. If you do this through ANOVA or analysis of variance, you'll know which particular price category is more influences, whether we are getting maximum number of sales with high price or medium price or with low price. So this particular research design is going to be called as completely randomized design. Problem with this design is researcher is considering that no extraneous variable is influencing this sales. And I think it is highly unlikely that no extraneous variable is going to impact your sales. So this particular example is going to give you some clarity about this completely randomized design. Moving further, there are some limitations of this completely randomized designs. And these are, this design suffers the main limitation that it does not make into account the effect of extraneous variable. I have already told you, like, they don't consider the impact of extraneous variable. They have initially assumed that no extraneous variable is going to impact your sales performance, but this is highly impractical. Second one is, different stores are the test units with where different price level was implemented. So it can also create problem. Different level of price level were implemented at different stores. So you won't be able to practically measure the difference of impact of all those price changes. Third one is the extraneous variable in the present example may be the size of the store, competitor's price of the substitute product in question. But unfortunately, we are not considering impact of all these things. we have already assumed that these things are not going to impact the performance. So we haven't taken this into consideration. And last two important limitations, the assumption of the effect of extraneous variable may not be true. I have already discussed it and told you earlier also. And the design is very simple and inexpensive to conduct because only two variables are involved. We can directly create the relationship by considering that no extraneous variables is impacting the dependent variable. So let's move further. But before moving further, erase all these marks, but otherwise it will move into the next slide. Now, next type is randomized block design. In randomized block design, what kind of a structure these people are considering? In the randomized block design, it is possible to separate the influence of one extraneous variable on a particular dependent variable and thereby providing a clear picture of the impact of the treatment of testing. You will not be able to understand the meaning of this statement unless until you consider it by practical example. So we'll give you a practical example in the next slide, but this example is of 12 stores, 12 retail stores of different sizes, like a small, medium and large sizes. Price level is low, medium and high. Once again, repeat this particular statement. This statement says, influence of one extraneous variable on a particular dependent variable, thereby providing a clear picture of the impact of the treatment on the test units. Now, if you consider two situations are there. We are varying the price, and on the variability of the price, like price is varying with low, medium and high, along with we are also varying the store sizes, like store sizes can be small, medium and large. So if we want to create or make a relationship between the price and the sales, we are here basically trying to negate the impact of this store size, because for price and sales relationship, the store size can be one of the extraneous factor. So this is the beauty of this particular randomized block design. They usually try to negate, they usually try to see the change with the store size also. Take this example further. I'll give you clarity on this on the next slide, but before moving ahead, let's move to the next slide. Now this is the example and see this very carefully. These are the stores. I have already told you 12 stores are there, but in 12 stores also we have segregated it into price level of low, medium and high. And this entire categorization is done for a smaller store. This entire categorization is done for medium store, and the last one is for large store. Suppose if you consider this combination. In this combination, first one is, let's take this highlighter. First one is store one, and we are selling at the low price. Some amount of unit must be sold here, say 12, 13, 14, 15, 16. Likewise, in low price in a smaller store, there must be certain combination of units sold. In medium, the same kind of structure is going to be observed. If with high price, the same kind of structure we may observe. So if you consider this small, this one. For small, this is the combination. For medium store, this is the combination. And for large stores, these are the combination. If you see the change in the next slide, we'll come to know. Now, this is the exact figure. With low price and first store, a store is able to sell 10 units. Second store able to sell 11 units. Third store is able to sell 9 units. Likewise, if you sum it up at low price, we are able to sell 100 units. See this. Change this or erase everything first and see the price change only. This one. Yes. We are able to sell 100 units. In the second case, we are able to 98 units. In third case, we are able to sell 86 units. So if you sum it up all in all, in a combination of small store and these three types of prices, we are able to sell this much unit, 284. In the second combination of medium store with three kind of prices, we are able to sell this 258 units. With third combination of large store and three types of prices, we are able to sell 222 units. And if you compare these three performances, like 284, 258 and 222, you easily can recognize that 284 is the highest sell, and which we people have got through the combination of smaller store and these three kinds of prices. So this particular combination is giving you maximum performance of 284 units. Like which will also gauge some different levels of sales through this. So we are also going to measure their performance on the basis of different combinations. But for this particular example, we have got this. So in randomized block design, we try to establish different levels of price and different stores and different types of stores on their sales performance. These are the sales performance, and we are checking it small store size, medium store size. So these store sizes can be extraneous variable, and we are checking the impact of extraneous variable on the price change, high, medium and low. And this can only be done through this randomized block design. Now let's move to the next slide, but before move ahead, erase everything, and then we'll cover Latin square research, Latin square experimental design. In Latin square research design, this design is employed when the researcher is interested in separating out the influence of two extraneous variables. In previous, they were trying to see the impact of extraneous variable on two variables. Now here they are trying to separating out the influence of your extraneous variables. Third, they are also saying that suppose the interest is to influence the price treatment on the sales, there be three levels of prices, like in the previous slides also we have taken this low, medium and high, and store size and packaging can also be included in this. In the same example, we'll also going to, so in the last randomized block design, we have taken store size, three levels of price, store size and sales performance. Now we are going to add one more thing, that is packaging. Namely, store size would be there, and third one would be packaging. So let's move into the next slide to see the main chart. It will clear things for you. Now, as I told you in the previous slide, three things can be gauged in this. And what all those three things are, let's start with this. First one is packaging. Second one is store size, and these are the three price level, individual price level. If you want to know the impact of packaging on sales, we can easily calculate the impact and take these combinations. Like at this one, this is packaging one, this is packaging two, second type of packaging, third type of packaging, these are store sizes, small store size, medium store size, and large store size. And on the basis of these three combinations, third combination is of price, X1, X2, and X3. X1 is low price, X2 is medium price, and X3 is higher price. So if we want to know the combination or sales performance on the basis of your packaging, store size, as well as price. So if you take example of this particular block, here these three combinations would be there. Packaging type would be one, store size would be small, and price level would be lower price. So if you take these three combinations, we'll be able to take the exact picture and we can create several combination of, and we fill it up this. And by filling it up, we'll come to know the best combination or best combination where we are getting the maximum sales. Like if this particular block is going to give me highest sales, so this can be taken as packaging. Second type of packaging, price, high range, and store size would be the minimum, medium store size, medium store size will give me the maximum sales. So I'm going to consider this combination, and this combination is going to come out of Latin square design. So here we are not only establishing the relationship between price and sales, but we are also checking the impact of packaging and a store size. These are two extraneous variables, and we are also checking those two extraneous variables. So we are taking considering three independent variable of price, and we are also checking packaging and store size impact. So this particular combination is going to be considered as Latin square combination. So let's move further. In this, it is all this thing, and this is the last experimental research design. So let's start with this factorial research design. And in this factorial research design, may be employed to measure the effect of two or more independent variables at various levels. Very important. Two or more independent variable at various levels. We'll clarify this statement in the example itself. The sales of the product may be influenced by two factors. For example, price can be low A1, medium and high A1, A2, A3. The store size would be small and big, B1 and B2. This could be conceptualized as a two-factor design with the information reported in the form of the table. Let's take this example here. Take this one as marker. So here two store sizes are there, and these are three price level, low, medium, and high. And we can create combination of these. That this particular cell will tell you a combination or sales performance due to store size, small store size, and low price. This will give you combination of small store size and medium price. This will give you combination of large store size and large price or higher price, and higher price and small store size. So likewise, we can fill the entire boxes with these, taking care of these two combinations. And this design is usually been considered as 3-into-2 design. And different combination gives the best possible option where we can get maximum sales. So this is the last statistical design. And we have almost covered the experimental research design. And as we have already covered all these things, now you'll be able to understand the structure of all the research design types. Like in exploratory research design, this is the statistical analysis. Maximum statistical analysis takes place in statistical designs. And degree of structure. As you move from exploratory research design, exploratory research design. As you move from exploratory research design to descriptive research design, pre-experimental, quasi-experimental, and statistical design, you are going to get more structured formats. You are going to get more structured formats because structured format is increasing from exploratory research design to statistical research design. So exploratory research design is the least structured format, while statistical research design is the most structured format. So we have almost covered your research design, and in the next chapter we are going to start the third unit. Next lecture video will start covering third unit from topic one. Up to this we have covered all research design types and different attributes related to the research design. Hope this lecture video is going to help you. I am going to add one link of Google Drive where you will be able to get all the important notes and material related to this PPTs. Apart from this PPT, you are also going to get notes in the Word file. So I think at the time of examination, you are going to get help from these uploads as well as these videos. So keep watching these videos and keep visiting this YouTube channel so that you can be updated about the latest video uploads. And I'm very much sure that you are enjoying this learning. Thank you so much for watching this lecture video. Thank you so much.